My name is Ginny Foos. I'm honored to be here, and it actually brings back some really great memories. When I was 10, I was on a television show outside of WGBH in Boston, which is where I grew up.
Okay.
And I was one of five panelists that had disabilities. And we filmed for 2 years. And it was a real coming of age experience for me because we were asked to sit on very hot sets talking about how do you feel about being different? How do you feel about being teased? And not only was I saving in psychological costs, I didn't have to see a shrink. I was actually being paid for talking about my feelings. And I really bonded with the other four individuals, and it was really neat.
How old were you when you sort of noticed yourself that you were different from other people, and maybe you, when your parents also noticed this?
That's a really good question. My parents were given the diagnosis when I was 18 months old, and they wonder to this day whether or not that was a delayed diagnosis, mm-hmm. that no one had the heart to break it to them. Now, this was pre-DNA testing. Mm-hmm. This was all based on x-rays and femur length. Femur is what they really go for in okay. measuring the femur length. And there we were sitting in Boston, one of the top medical communities in the country. And the gentleman that gave my parents the diagnosis was T. Barry Brazelton, who was sort of the Dr. Spock, not the sci-fi Dr. Spock, okay. but sort of the pediatric voice of America mm-hmm. in the 70s. And so I love to tell people that I was diagnosed by that man myself. So they knew when I was 18 months old. I think many little people like myself do not come to their own realization until they're in school, mm-hmm. because that's when the teasing really starts.
Sure.
And the accessibility, if you will, especially back then. Mm-hmm. You know, we're talking about the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
There wasn't any Americans with Disability Act.
Mm-hmm.
So that's when I was having to struggle to access what my fellow students were accessing. So I think the word has finally gotten out what the correct terminology is, but just in case, let me educate you on that. When Little People of America was first formed in 1957, the name was actually Midgets of America. It was primarily a venue for entertainers. And they kind of made light of their union, for lack of a better word. Well, then slowly educated, serious people started joining the group. And one of the first tasks at hand was to get rid of the word midget. Now, what's wrong with the word midget? For me and many others, it conjures up the image of vaudeville, when they were called midget performers. And they would go around, much like a traveling circus, and they would get on stage, and you would see a little person like myself with a cigar hanging out of their mouth and a diaper on,
mm-hmm.
and making total fools of themselves. So when I hear the word midget, that's what I conjure up in my mind, as do many in our organization. So I think the word is finally dying.
Mm-hmm.
Occasionally, it will be used in hockey leagues. It's still used up in Canada, signifying the younger kids, I think. And I think the little people group up there has been really working on that. So the terminology that I'm comfortable with, long-winded answer, is I'm comfortable with little person and I'm comfortable with dwarf, because that's what I was raised with. Now, that's not to say that my children, and they're okay with that too, but maybe my grandchildren will have come up with a new term.